The human characters that are difficult to do are the characters that are a middle range. One of the worst ones I had to do was Johnny Appleseed. He was just a mild, mannered little guy who never got mad at anybody. And...
the Lord is good to me, and so I thank the Lord for giving me the things I need, the sun and rain and an apple seed. Yes, he's been good to me.
Nobody could animate a handsome prince like Milt Kahl.
Today.
Oh!
Hello.
I know you. I walked with you once upon a dream. I know you. The gleam in your eyes is so familiar, a gleam.
But while they might have been virtuoso performances from Milt, they weren't much fun.
You have to accept these things. You have to accept them and do the best you can with them. You know, and you figure that you're always going to have characters in the picture that are entertaining. You know, so it doesn't hurt to have your straight jobs once in a while.
How do you draw characters in motion? Anything that moved, the Disney animators photographed and sketched. Beginning with Snow White in 1937, they studied live-action film. Milt Kahl, too, used live-action models, but the performances were always his own.
If you use live-action for reference, actually, truly, just for reference, that's great. I did this with Jungle Book. The way to use it, I think, is to learn so much about it that you don't have to use the reference anymore.
The Snow White animals had flour sack bodies. 5 years later, Bambi wobbled as only a deer or a Milt Kahl drawing of a deer could. Milt and the Disney animators had learned more about motion and anatomy than any group of artists in the world.
In appearance, physical appearance, we came as close to as we figured we possibly could to the real deer and still be able to articulate for dialogue and get and have a full range of expressions.
Go on, say hello.
Hello.
I think that I had as much to do with the Disney style, with creating a Disney style as anybody over the years.
The release of Bambi marked the end of an era for Milt and for the Disney studio. From 1942 to 1949, the only theaters that mattered were European and Asian theaters of war. Always a staunch patriot, Disney turned his studio over to the war effort. Milt Kahl worked as a stagehand instead of a star until the curtain came down on World War II.
Right in the poor's face.
I worked on... Walt did a series of propaganda films. One was Education for Death. One was Reason and Emotion. I remember a scene in Education for Death when this mother is praying over her child. He wasn't going to get killed or get swept up in this Nazi movement or something.
Heil Hitler.
Was ist denn schon wieder los mit Hans? Ist denn schon wieder?
It was just a spot thing, and you never got to know this woman or anything. So, but I did enjoy just getting a good performance out of that one little thing there.
With the military in charge of his studio, Walt struck off for South America to make a series of films for the U.S. State Department.
On Saludos Amigos, that was one of those. I did a thing called Lake Titicaca, which featured the duck in Peru. And they had a scurry of a llama in this thing. It was kind of funny.
From 1942 to 1949, Disney produced only short cartoons played mainly for laughs. Milt Kahl on short cartoons? It was like Olivia joining the Three Stooges. At last, Milt found a challenge in Song of the South, a combination of animation and live action released in 1946.
The animated sections were rather, I always thought, a high for us. You know, they were, the characters were, well, I've often said that if there's anything good about our pictures, it's because the characters were rich. Well, they were rich there. You know, you had, they were very rich and very contrasting, you know. So you had this bear with a one-track mind and the mind of a child, really. And he's very slow-witted.
What I said was, I'm gonna knock his head clean off.
And then you had this very, very sharp-witted fox who outsmarted himself all the time, you know.
Please, Brother Fox, please don't bring me in that prophet.
Bypats? Bypats! I'm glad I thought of that. Yes, indeed, I sure am glad I thought of that.
But you ain't gonna bring me in there, is you?
Me? Oh, no. We ain't gonna do that.
And then you have the rabbit who's put on quite a show to outwit the fox, you know, and act like he was terribly scared, and especially when he got to outsmart him, got him to throw him in the briar patch, you know, where he was born and bred. After the war, I think the studio only had enough money to meet the payroll for 6 weeks. It was a very marginal thing. And I believe it was about that time when we all took a voluntary cut in our salaries. And that went on for about a year or two, you know, until they got back on their feet again.
What got them back on their feet was a return to the animated features beginning in 1949 with Cinderella.
Oh, God, everyone was delighted to get back to work on something that was important.
As audiences saw when they saw Cinderella's fairy godmother, Milt Kahl still had the touch with characters.
What is she doing?
Salagadoola-mentra-gaboola-bibbidi-bobbidi-boo. Put them together, and what have you got? Bibbidi-bobbidi-boo. Salagadoola-mentra-gaboola-bibbidi-bobbidi-boo. It'll do magic, believe it or not. Bibbidi-bobbidi-boo.
I like the characters in Sword in the Stone very much. You know, Merlin was a very rich character. Lovers of the Arthur legend became incensed at the way we made Merlin a kind of a doddering magician, you know. And I thought that's where he had his charm, because he was sort of bumbling, you know.
Oh, all right, let's start again. Where was I, boy?
Hockety-pockety?
Oh, yes, that's right. Pockety-pockety-wockety-whack. Odds and ends of brick. You must be with you in just a minute. Packing's almost done.
What'd you do?
You bundling blockhead.
Hey!
Easy there. No, go ahead. Dumb-goodly-doodly-doodly-dumb. This is the best part now. Tickety-spiggity-spiggity-spoom. Prestidigitonium. Tickety-spiggity-spiggity-spoom. Prestidigitonium.
What a way to pack.